The end. Or is it? Today on another episode of the Bible in 1 year with the preacher's husband. Today, we're going through Revelation chapter 19 through 22. And tomorrow, I ain't doing anything. I'm going to take the day off and I'm not going to make a video. That's what I'm going to do tomorrow. So, let's dive in to what we have today. And it is Revelation 19 through 22. So, in Revelation 19, we're starting out with a celebration in heaven, and we get this imagery of this rider on a white horse, and there's all kinds of explanations here about what this could be, who this could be, who it's going to be. There's reference to that red cloak, the robe dipped in blood, as it was called for. The rider on the white horse, he basically says, "Then I saw heaven open, and there was a white horse. Its rider was called Faithful and True, and he judges and makes war with justice. His eyes were like a fiery flame, and many crowns were on his head. He had a name written that no one knows except himself." To me, that means Jesus, because we're not supposed to know the name of Jesus when he returns, right? When God returns, when Christ returns to the world, we're not going to know what his name until after he's here. But everybody's going to know that's him, though. And then he'll reveal his name later. So he wore a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. So clearly this is referring to Jesus, as we saw in 1 John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. So it's God. There's God. Now, we're going to move on from here to chapter 20. Now, chapter 20's got some controversies going on. Satan gets bound up. The saints reign with Christ. And then there's a satanic rebellion after this 1,000 years of peace happens. It says when the 1,000 years are completed, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea. Now, this brings up this millennial viewpoint, the view of the 1,000-year period, right? Now, there are three predominant views regarding how to understand the Bible's teaching on the millennial reign of Christ. Now, the premillennial view holds that the millennium is a literal 1,000-year reign of Christ on earth that will take place just after the return of Christ. Now, the post-millennial viewpoint holds that the millennium happens during this church age, and the return of Christ will take place after this 1,000 years of peace. Now, the amillennial view holds that there is no literal millennium reign of Christ here on earth, but instead symbolically represents Christ's reign in the hearts of God's people during the church age. I'm not really sure I buy into any of those three views. Not really sure. I kind of lean towards the third one the most, but who knows? And this is why, another reason why, you shouldn't really spend too much time dwelling on prophecies and what's going to happen and how it's going to happen, because honestly, we're not even supposed to know. The Bible even tells us we're not even supposed to know. We're not supposed to know that moment and that nobody will know, and Jesus is going to come like a thief in the night. Nobody's going to know until the time that it happens. Once it happens, boom, there it is. So we got to be ready all the time. You got to be ready. So get ready. Be ready. And here we are in 21. "And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth," in chapter 21, verse 1. And there are some amazing imagery here. In verse 4, it says, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away. Then the one seated on the throne said, 'Look, I am making everything new.'" God's going to be doing a new thing when all of this happens. And death and grief and crying and pain, all that's going to be over with. And then, of course, we get to this visual of the New Jerusalem. And it is a beautiful, beautiful place, according to this. And then we move on to the last chapter, chapter 22. The source of life is discussed. And of course, the time is getting near. We get to chapter 22, verse 13, and those famous words there: "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." This is Jesus. This is God. He was, is, and is to come, as it says here. And of course, we end this. This is in verse 18 and 19. It says, I testify to everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the word of this of the book of this prophecy, God will take away his share of the tree of life and the holy city, which are written about in this book. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean this whole Bible, if you change anything in it, if in the whole Bible, if you take a word out or put a word in or you add a little bit to it, or no, that's not what it means at all, actually. John is actually, when he refers to this book, he is talking about the book that he is writing, which is the book of Revelation. These 22 chapters in the book of Revelations. He is not specifically referring to the whole Bible. He is referring to the book of Revelation. Some people take this out of context and say, if you make any changes in this book, I mean, if you say anything that's different in any of these pages, then you're taking away and you're putting back and you're going to burn. And that's not what he's saying here. That's not really what he's saying. He's talking about the book of Revelation. And you know what? We're really not supposed to know when he's coming. So what difference would it make if we put all of the effort into translating and predicting and interpreting all of these prophecies and line them up exactly with the proper events as they're going to be, and we predict exactly the moment that Jesus is going to come back? What good does that really do us if we're not ready to go and we're not right with him to begin with? It's not going to do us any good. So, verse 20, he who testifies about these things says, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with everyone. Amen. Now, just because I'm on my very last video here doesn't mean I'm not ever going to make a video again. I am going to make more videos, and I've got some Bible studies planned that I'm going to do in the future, but I'm going to take a week or two off and not do any videos for the next week or two. But then after that, I'll get back into possibly doing a Bible study video, maybe a weekly. And also, I'll be writing a book in the future here soon, too. So I'm going to get started on that. That's going to consume some of my time. And I may even do some videos to update you on progress of that as we go along as well. So I hope this has helped you in your studies throughout this past year. If it has, of course, click that like button and subscribe button for the next stuff I'm going to do. If you're rumbling with me on Rumble, hit that little box and go. And I hope to see you again in the future, in another episode of something that is not going to be the Bible in 1 year with the preacher's husband. It'll be something completely different. Either way, I'll see you then.